centers, because, as you know, SEI has offices across the globe. And it's nice to Kerstin, who is the chairwoman of SEI Global Board and has really extensive and impressive experience in international environmental policy and research as well. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Excellency, former ministers, colleagues and friends of SEI, it is indeed a great pleasure for me and the board of SEI to be here in Tallinn, this beautiful city, so rich in historical memories. When SEI was set up more than 25 years ago, with centers in different parts of the world, Tallinn was one of the first locations selected. Estonia is geographically important, on the border between East and West, and also to Central Europe. And of course, many links with Sweden over the centuries. Today, both Sweden and Estonia are fellow members of the European Union, which makes Estonia even more important as a center location, not least in view of the upcoming EU presidency. The achievements here are impressive. You are a forerunner in digitalization and also in the field of energy environment. You have already reduced substantially your CO2 emissions, and you have ambitious strategies and plans to achieve even more. We believe that SEI could help in the work that lies ahead. SEI is a global organization. We have centers in the US, in the Great Britain, in Bangkok, in Nairobi, and of course also Stockholm. We have outstanding scientists working in close contact with decision makers, public and private, on all levels, local, national, and international. We have experts involved in the ICCP panel. Our projects range from sustainability in the Arctic to bioscience innovation in Africa. We do not just make scientific reports for the bookshelves. We do concrete work on the ground with local experts. There are many environmental think tanks. We are proud to be considered one of the 10 highest ranks in the world. In fact, currently number 3. We are very much involved in the new climate economy initiative and, of course, the new sustainability development goals. Over the years, we have developed a fruitful cooperation with the Swedish government. We discuss regularly their needs and our potential projects. And when Sweden had the EU presidency, we helped to prepare the informal meeting of environment ministers. Through our network of experts working for the different centers, we have access to a wide range of knowledge and contacts. We hope that we can develop a fruitful collaboration also with the Estonian government. We are really pleased to have Lauri Tammiste as our new center director with his excellent experience and background in several ministries and financing, and we have great expectation for the center under his leadership. Today's seminar is about energy and environment. This link is obvious to all of us in this room, hopefully also to most policy and decision makers in all over the EU, as well as the people. And we know now that the ways how we produce and use energy are crucial for the environment, not least the future climate. But this awareness has not always been there. In fact, it is rather recent. I know from my personal experience, I have worked with environment and energy issues for almost 50 years. In the 60s, the technology optimism was overwhelming. Nuclear power for energy production was considered a blessing. The only environmental concern was that cooling water could increase the temperature of coastal water. In the 70s, the understanding of risks with nuclear power as well as fossil fuel increased. Acidification was a growing problem in several European countries because of sulfur emissions from fossil fuel. But when we raised this concern with the big emitters, Germany and the United Kingdom, we were laughed at. In the 80s, discussion about CO2 emissions and climate change started to spread among scientists. For instance, the Swedish meteorologist Bert Bolin, who initiated the ICCP and also chaired SEI. In 1992, we had the UN Conference on Environment and Development in Rio, which started the UN work on climate change and the annual COPs. In the EU, environment ministers at that time were very much aware of the threat of climate change. Angela Merkel was one of them. But they did not have much support from their fellow ministers. They were rather lonely, and media attention as well as public awareness very limited. The Kyoto Protocol gave some hope, but when President Bush decided to kill the Kyoto process in 2001, despair and resignation were near. The EU managed to save the UN process, and gradually the awareness increased remarkably, I would say. More than we could have dreamt of. And as a result, political pressure increased. Nick Stern showed the economic costs of inaction. Al Gore produced his film. And suddenly we had the finance ministers and prime ministers and energy ministers speaking about climate change and the importance of action. And also the private sector. At last, we had a successful UN COP in Paris last year, which demonstrated the commitment of so many countries, including Estonia. And as you said there, Minister Pomerantz, economic growth does not need to come at the expense of the environment. You also mentioned the example of digital signatures and the savings possible if this was applied worldwide. There are many such examples of technological development, both for production of energy and more efficient use. I'm a strong believer in the potential of technology and the spread of best practice. And I think we now have a better chance than ever to achieve the goals set. I look forward to listening to your achievements in the areas of transport and housing. And I hope very much that SEI, with our worldwide network, can become a useful ally in the work ahead. Thank you.
Kerstin, can I give you a small gift?
Oh.
And thank you for the kind introduction and words.
Thank you very much.
And yes, I was just reminded also that the whole seminar will be transmitted electronically, so also warm welcome to the viewers over the web. And now we have time to start our panel discussion. So it's my pleasure to invite here Marko Pomerantz, the Minister for Environment, and also Mrs. Keit Pentus-Rosimannus, former Minister of Environment, currently a member of parliament, but we get the five ministers for the price of two, actually, because Marko, you've been minister also of social affairs and internal affairs, and Kate has been also minister of foreign affairs, so very energy and resource efficient solution instead of having huge panel. So thank you very much for coming here and accepting our invitation. As Kerstin was also saying, I think people coming from outside and viewing at Estonia, they really notice and appreciate the actually huge changes that we have gone through. Sometimes we ourselves tend to forget how bad the situation was and how big a transition we have actually made. So maybe we should first start out by really what is your kind of personal experience and feeling that what have been the key drivers behind this success that we have really started, you know, from zero and reaching quite a high level of renewables in our energy mix. Also, we see that there's a huge decrease in greenhouse gas emissions. So what has been, in your mind, the key drivers behind this transition?
Mitte, et ma sulle seda sokutaksin.
Well, thank you. First, I must, but I'm happy to admit that I also think that SEI has played a quite important role in keeping that issue on the agenda and keep on pushing also among the politicians to have the issue of energy efficiency, but also climate policy on the agenda. But I think I would start even not mentioning the very concrete political decisions that, of course, have played an extremely important role. But I would rather start from 1990s and from the switch in the mindset that happened at the time, at least as I understand it. Because I do think that since we started, like you said, we started from zero, which meant that our economy was in very, very bad shape, well, in tatters. It was very clear that the country was very poor. Sometimes I say that it was our luck to be poor, because if you have not many resources, if you are not very rich country, or if you are not very big country, you have to find a way to do more with using less. And I think this has also and always been a mindset that has been extremely important also in energy efficiency field, for example. So for us, it was clear that if we want to be competitive as a country, we had to find ways to be innovative, to find new ways, and to find and to be effective in economical sense. So that was one thing in our mindset. And another thing that is, I think, very important when we talk about the energy in Estonia is that we have always had that strange noise back in our heads saying that we always have to do everything we can to be as independent as possible. Our electricity production, as you know, is based on the oil shale, has been based on oil shale for a very long time, which has given us independence from other countries, or what other countries, from Russia, when it comes to the electricity production. But it's very clear that also renewables is extremely important part of being independent. So this, again, this mindset of having or and supporting those possibilities that helps to be independent is and has been very, very important. So this is one of the things why renewables, I think, are or have been growing very quickly here in Estonia. But of course, there are also concrete political decisions like having this support scheme or subsidizing scheme for renewables that has been criticized heavily here in Estonia, just like probably in every other countries where similar kind of schemes are there, because it's not very popular among the consumers to have those subsidies and to see on their bill, that electricity bill, that they also pay for renewables. But again, it's I think in Estonia there is an understanding that having independence is something that does not really have the price. And having renewables makes us more independent also in energy-wise, and this is one thing that unfortunately has also the price tag with itself. But
Good afternoon. I just gave word, first word to Kate, not because to use that moment for thinking, but ladies first, even in Estonia, and so it should stay. What a happy week. We talk right now about low carbon economy, and we celebrate just in the same week our 100 years of oil shale industry. So it means that both they are in our schedule and even in mine as a Minister of Environment. And just comment about that signage, which was given by myself in New York. I did it in old-fashioned way, with my not excellent hand, but everybody can read it. It's Marko Pomerants, and so it is, and I took it seriously. Kate actually already mentioned all those factors. I do it in very concrete way. First factor, how we happen to be here where we are. First, it just happened because there was a change of state system, we can say. One collapsed and there was need just to build up a new economical system. It's the first one. Second, of course, we have political tools also. If we talk about green energy subsidies or just that small support, which is not so small, which was given by our Environmental Investment Center during 7 years for more than 100 projects just to go over to the biofuels. And third one, which is a natural factor, we have a lot of easy accessible biomass. Aspen, all the trees, it's just here.
You have, Marko, also background in geology and actually very intimate knowledge of the oil shale. From really the time you studied and then you went on to work in actually environmental protection and civil service, that how do you see, how has changed the perception of the oil shale and the discussion over these years? Do you see now that there is actually the shift in mentality, there is this shift of perception and discussion? Yeah. What's the difference between 20 years ago, 10 years ago, now, discussion?
I think the difference is huge, and if we talk about where from we started and if we have a scale, I think we started from 100% of oil shale in scale, and today the mix is totally different, and every or most of people still think that if we talk about Estonian Energy as a stock company, then it's just a company which produces only oil shale or just electricity from oil shale or oil, but people who know, they know that Estonian Energy Company also moves as all world or Europe does. If we talk about wind energy, for example, they participate their role. If we why we have now such a difficulties with that biomass topic and how to use it and how much and where and to produce what? It's again because of Estonian Energy, because they started it very heavily, how to say. And maybe in that time not in the best way, and now we should find a right track and be smarter.
Can I add, yes. Also not yes. being a geologist and not having a background in geology, I still want to add that I think the image or the perception of oil shale industry has changed, especially during the last years, and it has changed into better. And I think there are several reasons for that. One is that the oil shale companies themselves admit and have done huge investments to make the energy production cleaner. And that they are, in fact, finding ways how to use the resource, the oil shale itself, in a more efficient way, how to get more out of it, not simply so to say burn, but find new ways, innovative ways to use it, and to do it more and more environment-friendly way. I also think that now it is very clear that the road towards the cleaner energy production and cleaner economy is very much there, and that is the road that we have chosen as a country. And also the industry itself now tries really hard to not be an obstacle, but to work with all the rest of the society. So I do think that the image has been has turned into better. And of course, since the oil shale industry is not very big, I think it is the biggest polluter as well, but as they are the biggest polluters, they also pay the highest amount and the biggest amount of the resource taxes and the pollution taxes. And since Estonian environment tax system is organized so that it is redirected to the environment projects, I think also that has been recognized as an important thing. So I think they have worked. And then, of course, they must work to have their image improved.
Kerstin was saying that in the early 90s, environmental ministers were feeling alone on this issue. Marko, are you feeling alone on this issue or not?
Honestly.
No.
At the moment, not. Yes, no. You're with Kate. No. But other than that, I mean, now the Ministry of Environment has put together this low-carbon roadmap up until 2050. So what has been the discussion with your fellow ministers? So what's the perception?
I think it's not so complicated. In Estonia, people think that if we talk about environmental issues, then it's only about protection, but it's also about use. And I have such a thought that if we think about which kind of impact can have a minister of environment to the industries, and which impact can have minister of economics or entrepreneurship? I think here is a huge difference, and I can say from my side that my understanding is the same, at least from 1995. I was interviewed, and the question was, I started to be a governor of West Viru County. And the question from journalist was that now you came from a field of environment. I was head of environmental board in West Viru County, and now you should take care of jobs and working places and so on. And I said then, and I can say it now, for industry, yes, for not for every price. And so it is today, and if we move to low carbon society, I think it's wise, despite of the fact that we have now understanding that carbon causes climate change and so on. It's wise anyway. It makes us richer, and despite of the fact. And just if we try to put together some kind of strategies for 2030 or 2050, I think all parties understand the need. Of course, everybody has their own altitude, and economical people say more production, and I say more protection. But I think if wise people are in room, you can have also good results.
But Kate also, as I introduced you, served as a Minister of Foreign Affairs. So Estonian, I think, foreign policy has been very much about security policy and really tighten the relations with allies. But how much do you see your fellow colleagues, how high has been, you know, rising the issue of environment and international agreements on a table of foreign ministers?
Again, I think that it is the overall question of competitiveness. It's the question of competitiveness, not just one industry, not even just one country. I think it is a huge importance of whether EU can be competitive on a worldwide arena. And as I see it, it's very clear that population is rising in the world, increasing. So there will be more and more consumers. There will be more and more demand. But the resources are there as much as they have been. It's very clear that the urbanization is a trend that will influence the world entirely, not only the Europe, but the world during the next 30, 50 years. The prediction says that after some, well, before the 2015, around 70% in the world live in the cities, at least. So that will be 70% out of 9 billion people. It all directly influences also the demand of energy. And of course, it is very clear that to have more innovative solutions in the energy field is directly connected with the competitiveness. It's directly connected with the people's health. So it's not just the question of ministers of environment. It's very clearly the questions of practically every minister, I would say. We have the ministries of economy and finance on European level who, work hard to find and discuss about how we could be more competitive, and also the energy and environment issues are more and more also on their agenda. So I would say that it's and of course also for the ministers of foreign affairs, especially when it comes to the energy independence.
Just made a fresh Estonian environmental knowledge study, and we asked especially about energy production and how people feel about that. And what was interesting, it's not surprising that most of people just support renewable energy production, and 89% from them from wind, and 76% from biomass, and 49% were totally against energy production, but
was there also question from oil sale, if it's okay in their backyard?
Oil sale, because but I wanted to say there is always, but if you go to West Estonia, which is actually by different reasons, only region where you can have new windmills, and if you read what happens, for example, in Hiiumaa against open sea wind parks, then you can see that maybe there are those 11% who said no, never. And they don't really so much care what happens in east, maybe, where is oil shale production area. But of course, people in East Viru, they support still production of oil shale and energy from that, and reason is totally different. It's working about the working places. Sure. But what is also interesting, what is the reason why people support such understanding that renewable energy is most important, or what is important in energy production? And it's so that 46% said most important is sustainability of production. And as we politicians always use that price argument, it was a surprise to me also that 31% considered price of energy to be most important, only 31%. And security issue was always also very important to Estonians. And from that study, we understand that 23% of people think that the security argument is most important. So there have been changes in our minds and people's minds also.
So it really seems that this study is kind of, I think it really reflects the change in mentality. It used to be energy security and price issues. I remember there was a lot of discussion about when the electricity market was opening and when the first subsidies came and it went on the bill. But now it seems that actually Minister of Economy, who has been working tirelessly, I think, for 6 years, to reform the subsidies, they can now stop it, the work, because actually people are now willing to pay.
No, it's not also foolproof.
I think when we talk about the subsidies, the renewable subsidy system, things that are not very often discussed or that some politicians are afraid to say it out loud was is that the whole system, the idea of subsidizing whatever industry field or whatever industry is that there must be some obstacle on the market. And for me, the renewable subsidies are there to help the renewables, the technology, to become competitive and to make them as competitive as other technologies. And at least as I see it, the final goal should be to have those technology as competitive or to have them functioning on a market-based way. So also the subsidies cannot be there forever. So I think this is something that we must acknowledge as well. Mm. Once the renewables are competitive, also the subsidies must come to an end. But it's also it means that also the fossil fuels or the fossil fuel based technologies cannot be subsidized. So there must be a fair treatment of both technologies.
So regarding the taxation and subsidies, I mean, on one hand we have had excellent, I think, resource taxes and charges system where really. If you use the resource, if you pollute, you pay, and this money goes back to the environmental projects. But on the other hand, also government took the decision to exempt oil shale industry. So, Marco, what's your take on this?
Yeah, it actually, the process also was in different stages. When we started in Narva, there was idea that there should be exemption also from pollution taxes. And for my understanding, it can't be so, because if you use resources, you pollute, you pay whatever is economical situation. And then in the second stage, it turned to only resource taxes stayed on table. And my conclusion is very simple. Of course, from one hand, for a minister of environment, it seems very nice that all factories are just not working, no any pollution at all, but you know what is behind that, that it's a huge system where you have mines, you have factories, you have people, and you still have your environmental problems in area. So for me, just working factory is better than just factory which doesn't work and problems are still in area. And hopefully we can reach to the situation where, old system or new system, which we also prepare, where all outside costs are taken into consideration and market prices are changing, still then start to work for the same purposes, that we have more money to invest again to tackle with those environmental problems. I take it in very patient way now, that result which we got out from it.
Okay, but we have talked quite a lot about the energy sector, oil shale sector, but I know, Kate, you have been really advocating that looking beyond and about the green economy and clean tech and all these innovative solutions. How do you see it? Has Estonia progressed in that field to see new businesses emerging in other areas as well?
I think we are doing excellent job, actually, to be honest. And I also think that we don't even realize ourselves that some solutions we have on our table or some solutions we are using are also doing a huge, a very good job also when it comes to the environment protection or again energy efficiency. I sometimes use the example that you know we have this digital signature solution here in Estonia. It's the secure digital signature we have here, and thanks to that we save about 2% of the GDP each year in Estonia, which is approximately the same amount, a bit less than we use for our defense budget. 2% of GDP in Estonia, and that is. But what we don't always think is that we always also save the pure energy, so to say. If we didn't have the digital signature, if we didn't use it as much as we do, we would produce each month a paper mountain that would be as high as Eiffel Tower each month in Estonia. So why I'm saying is that this is only in Estonia. Think what would be the effect if we had the similar system at least between and in the Nordic countries. You know, in Estonia, we are working hard to have the X-Road, the similar system working between Finland and Estonia, but also Sweden, Denmark, so on. And if we had the similar system in whole Europe, what would be the effect for the European economy and for the energy efficiency?
Lots of standing pulp and paper.
Yes, but again, I mean, you don't have to run and drive with your papers between the cities and fly between the countries. So this is just one example that sometimes for us it is so natural that we don't even connect it anymore, and we don't see that it's also it does have effect also on the energy efficiency side. But I honestly, I do see the possibilities everywhere. In Estonia, still 40% of the energy is used in the housing. So think what is the potential there, 40% of energy used in housing. Transportation and so on. So yes, there are huge possibilities still out there. There are a huge amount of very, very active, innovative, open-minded young entrepreneurs who try to find solutions there, working also very closely with universities that I think is very, very important to have that connections there. So I think if we will gather in 5 years, oh, there will be many new success stories to talk about.
I am such an old man, I remember ministers from 90s also. Every Tuesday in that time, they went to cabinet meeting and they had just 2 kilos of everything available. Today, we have still ministries with portfolio and without. But actually, there is no need for portfolio anymore. But I still have one Italian one. I have fresh socks there inside.
The socks really come handy when changing the climate. But I'm really shocked to discover that actually we are really running close to the end of our panel. I know, Kate, you must be at 3 o'clock back to the parliament. So I will have 2 questions maybe from the audience to really perhaps. Yes. As it is via web also broadcasted, then please use microphone.
Thank you a lot, CBS Secretariat. I have seen 4 or 5 latest government decisions locking Estonian energy production system to the oil shale. What do you think the damage done by those decisions and creating such uncompetitive situation for the renewables? How many years it will take to overcome this damage?
Nobody can count it, I think, but you should see what happens in longer run. And you should know that as a cabinet member that if you have a company, we call it, for example, Estonian Energy, there are assets also. So you can't just throw them away and start from next day as nothing happened. So for me, it's interesting what happens during next 14 or 34 years when I still alive and can see what movements have been done in during those years.
I cannot really answer that question, and I cannot name the number of years. I very much agree that persistence in policy is something that is hugely important when it comes to the path towards the cleaner and more or less CO2 emitting economy, and also when it comes to the renewables. And this is one of the things that has been the biggest or the worst claim towards the politicians, not in Estonia, but in the whole EU, not to have persistent policy. And this is why I think that the Paris Agreement had really, really huge importance. Before the Paris Agreement, you all know that there were huge speculations that finally this climate policy is dead. You know, there are a lot of skeptics who keep on hoping for that. But the Paris Agreement did happen. It has been ratified already for very many countries, already for a couple of EU member states. I very much hope that Estonia can ratify it as soon as possible. And that has been a very clear signal again that there will not be a change or a switch on the climate policy. The direction is still the same. I very much hope that the politicians, no matter in which countries, do not send mixed signals towards the private industries, because sometimes there are questions whether the private industry can be on board, or how can we get the private industry on board. I think the private industry is ready to be on board, and it is already on board, but in order to make investments that are huge, they must have certainty that the way we are going will be clear, and there will be no switches and some sudden turns on the way. So I agree that persistence and clear policy line must be there from Estonian government as well as all the other EU governments.
Okay, so Helen, one more question from a gentleman from the audience. Just as a hint, he actually is also former Minister of Environment from Sweden, so our board member.
Thank you, and just with that background, now also as a member of the SEI board, I really appreciated your contributions today. And I'm just curious to hear a little bit more on how you consider cost efficiency looking at the energy system as such. And I think maybe that could be also a topic where we could also create further cooperation between SEI and also the political needs here in Estonia and other places. I mean, compare Sweden with its long goal of really getting rid of oil, and where I think we have been successful. You can still see that costs on different energy resources has shifted enormously during these decades as we have been within transition. And I think it's due to our experience so important really to both create, build a broad political support for a system which is clear. And now today it's mostly about the green electric certificates, where we had five parties, a broad majority of the parliament, agreeing on creating further subsidies within until 2030. And it's really based on a market economy system, which is the most, I would say, cost efficient way of really creating those supporters or subsidies, and definitely more so than compared to with a feed-in tariff system. So I think it could just be interesting on elaborating further on that, and really to create further visions on how to create cost efficiency linked to certain targets and objectives and let them steer the result in the end. That is politically beneficial, I think.
Mm-hmm. I think, again, the picture or starting point of Sweden in 1990s and for Estonia, it's totally different. As I started, 100% was oil shale production. Today, there were already efficiency improvement because of, if we talk about electricity, market because of open market and North Pool, and we can produce electricity from oil sale only when it's efficient, is from one hand. And secondly, if we think about how to now move whether on with renewables, then the efficiency is again an issue. And why the debate was so long now with new energy development plans and so on. And the issue is just there, not to overcompensate. How, because in the end of day, it comes from people's pocket, and how to make changes so that it's not too costly. But lots of people in Estonia tried to argue that we started with very high subsidy level when we went over to renewables. I think because of such a high level, that was just a good start also. And now we should look 10 years later what might be just reasonable level or steps now for next 10 or 20 or 15 years.
I will just add one thing that, yes, cost efficiency is something that we need to discuss, and unfortunately we do not have that extra hour that at least would be needed here today, but I think also the, so to say, the alternative costs must be shown and explained again also by the politicians, by the experts, that what will be the cost if we do not pay and if we do not choose the road we have chosen. What will be the cost for health? What will be the cost for economy, and how it will influence the competitiveness? What, one thing that I every now and then argue with some Estonian politicians is that when we explain the changes we make in our energy portfolio in order to make it more mixed, not just based on one energy resource, we don't do it because somebody demands us to do it. We don't do it because of Kyoto. We don't do it because of Brussels. We don't do it because of anybody else. We do it because it helps our own citizens, and it helps our own country to be more independent, to be more competitive. And this is the reason why we do it. And also, again, to have those costs very clearly at the table so that people would understand what would it mean if those decisions were not made. But yes, the cost efficiency debate, I very much hope that one day we can have that too.
Actually, we can have today after the seminar in the buffet, when you're welcome to join. But you have to run, so I really...
I run too.
Yeah. But before you run, yeah, I will give a small gift back, and thank you really a lot for coming and discussing.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we luckily only have one event, and it seems I'm next one.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. So let's see. I hope this works. So I would say I will try to put some context around this discussion that we had, but also share some of the insights that I just, during the month that I have worked now at SEI Tallinn, actually gained already in the network. So some interesting new things. If we look at Estonia, where do we want to go? I think at least on paper, in a document, in strategy and policy, there seems to be very clear direction. There's the new long-term energy plan that has taken several years for the Ministry of Economy to prepare it. And it actually has really ambitious targets for 2030. So share of renewables, 50%. to keep final energy consumption at almost or similar to today's level, and really to cut the greenhouse gas emissions from energy sector and ETS sector by really significant amount. So the energy long-term plan puts competitiveness, environmental issues at the heart of the strategy. And it's really emphasizing that we should try to move at fair market prices. So this is one of the very important issues, that it's not only about energy, it's not only about environment, but it's very much competitiveness issue. It's an issue much wider. We also mentioned Ministry of Environment came up with the new foundations for climate policy, which had really extensive involvement of stakeholders. There was working groups of many experts from all of the sectors, academic, public institutions, private sector. And again, what it says is that the Estonian government wants to have the ambition of decreasing the emissions by approximately 80% by 2050. Again, these two documents, they outline very clear vision and very clear message. And this message, I would say, is the strongest in the context and history of environment and energy policy in Estonia. So is it doable? Of course, we can ask and should ask. Well, there was also extensive work on the possible impact of different scenarios. For the long-term energy plan, there was many analysis conducted, scenarios analyzed, and the results from this study, they were saying, yes, it's doable. Also, for the climate policy foundations, there was, again, lots of scenario building, lots of modeling, lots of analysis. The answer was, again, yes, it's doable. Also, our organization in 2013 made a study on the possibility of moving towards low carbon economy by 2050. Again, extensive analysis, modeling, using different tools. And again, the message was yes, but actually throughout all this analysis that I mentioned here and the background modeling, that the message was yes, but with business as usual approach. So business as usual doesn't cut it. With business as usual, going in the same direction or using the same tools as we have done so far, we don't reach these targets. So you need significantly to change the policy incentives, the economic environment, and also you need change technologies, change the behavior, and it's a huge effort to actually reach these targets. So is it going to be easy? No, definitely not. The investment numbers, well, they varied from study and assessment to study, but they were all in hundreds of millions of euros. So the order of magnitude was significant. So how do we get there? How do we reach these targets then? Well, it's very encouraging to say that actually all of our public institutions in Estonia are working very hard. There are lots of things in the pipeline. And actually, it's not only about very nice strategy documents, which are nice, I can assure you. But there are also lots of things in the pipeline, like updating the renewable electricity subsidy scheme that was discussed, further liberalizing the heat market, linking up gas markets, which, like electricity market 10 years ago, we didn't have connections, we didn't have multiple suppliers, we didn't have actually a marketplace. So now we all have all this in electricity area. So now it's time also to do the same in gas markets. So there's lots of also public support for investments in fuel switch. There's lots of support in energy efficiency in buildings, industry. There's also in transport, there's the plan to promote uptake of biofuels by blending and so on and so on. So many of policy instruments are already there or in the process of designing them. But these are, most of them are kind of regulatory push. And what was even more surprising was that if you convert this food amount into CO2 that has gone into the production of this food, then it's, I did this in the morning by just using fingers and some Googling. So if it's correct, then it's hundreds of millions of liters of petrol. So maybe it's more effective actually to really work on the food issue, which is very tangible, rather than building new mega metro systems and switching to new technology. So the message is really that actually the climate issue is in surprising areas, and you can have a big impact really by pointing out to the issue. And just last week, there was the executive order by President Obama on the behavioral insights. And it was interesting, really, that they one of the areas that they emphasized was that it helps to switching to carbon, low carbon economy. And really, sometimes it's not about actually investments, it's about lowering the barriers for entry, making the doing the right thing easy, simplifying the information. Also, if there are so many complex choices you have to make to be a sustainable and a prudent citizen, then you give up. And like I said, the non-financial incentives, they are very important. So as a conclusion, I would say there are lots of challenges ahead, but even more so opportunities ahead. Thank you. Okay, we are running a little bit tight on the schedule, but warm welcome to Charlie.
Thank you. Is this working? Okay, so what I'd like to talk to you about is some of SEI's experiences on the issue of energy planning. I'm not going to claim to be an expert at all on the situation here in Estonia, and I'm going to keep my comments primarily to the situation in developing countries. But some of the things, some of the topics I will raise, I think are relevant also globally. So the basic thesis is that energy planning as a topic really is in crisis today. So traditional approaches to energy planning, in primarily in developing countries, are beginning to fail. And the problems we're beginning to see today are only going to get much worse in the future. But that's not an excuse for not doing planning. I live in the US where planning is, you know, almost one of the dirtiest words you can say. But I'm not saying that we should throw it away. You know, markets alone cannot be relied upon to solve the challenges ahead, especially the climate and pollution challenges. So we do need planning, but it has to be something different from before. So I'm going to give you some thoughts on what needs to be different, and also just say a few words about some of the things that SEI is doing to address the challenge. So what can we say about traditional planning? Well, some of what I'll say applies mainly to planning of electricity, but I think it applies to energy and climate planning more generally as well. So traditionally, energy planning has been a very relatively simple top-down process, something that coupled very simple forecasts of what the demands for energy would be in the future, with most of the focus being on supply planning. So We would have very sort of top-down forecasts of how the demand for electricity and energy would increase over the coming years. And basically, the question was, how many power plants are we going to build in the future? That was essentially the process that governments would go through. And as markets have liberalized over the last 20 years, you know, a lot of that activity has moved down to the utility scale. So these approaches worked reasonably well. They never worked all that well. And in fact, going back to the 1970s, these kind of top-down approaches were seen to be vastly overestimating the growth in energy. In the US, famously, the utilities always forecast much more growth than really happens. But they worked reasonably well in certain situations. So they worked well when prices were stable and the supply of energy was fairly reliable. You were able to get away with these simple approaches when your energy system was relatively simple. You had large, centralized, monopolistic utilities, and there was a kind of a one-to-many relationship between the utilities and the energy system and sort of millions of customers out there. They also worked well when the supply was dominated by a few relatively large power plants, and you could dispatch those power plants in a fairly predictable way. So when the system was dominated by fossil plants and hydro plants, things weren't so complicated. Also, you could do this planning in a context knowing that you had many years ahead to get things right or wrong. So the plants took a long time to build, they had very long lifetimes, and the demand was growing gradually and predictably. So things were relatively easy. And also, we didn't have to worry about externalities in the past. You know, we didn't realize that the climate problem was emerging. It was as bad as we know it is today. And, you know, air pollution was really just an emerging problem. So we could largely ignore that problem. So when you had a simple system like this in developing countries, you had a large monopolistic system, this is actually a very good vehicle for pursuing some of your social policy. So in many countries over the last 20 years and still today, energy systems are used to pursue your social policy. So they're used to try and give cheaper power to poorer customers, particularly in countries like India and China. That's been a way of helping your development issues by cross-subsidizing your poorer consumers and asking your industries and your commercial consumers to pay more. And also because of this large system, typically you'd have parastatal utilities, so large government-owned utilities, and they would be a vehicle for government to pursue its social objectives. And this was usually done by just directing the utilities and telling them what to do. And the upshot of that is usually the utilities had to do it regardless of whether they could afford it or not. So you end up with these utilities that tend to be underfinanced, undercapitalized, and not very profitable. In fact, many of them make losses. But emerging trends are threatening this model. So we've been able to get away with that model for the last 30 years, but things are really beginning to change fast now. There's been unprecedented growth in renewable energy technologies. There's been large improvements in energy efficiency technologies. So all of those things go to make the whole system much more complicated and hard to predict. Large utilities are increasingly facing competition from private power producers. Partly that's as a result of government policies to open up the electric market. But it's also because we have this sort of behind-the-meter energy production going on now. So we have the emergence of solar power as a very important factor. People are referring to people producing power at home as prosumers, so they're producers and consumers. And there's been growing volatility in fuel prices, partly because trade has increased in the energy sector, so the fuels needed to go into power plants are a much more global commodity now. So if there's demand or supply shocks, those tend to reverberate around the world, and things are getting much more volatile. There's also emerging technologies for better managing loads, so demand-side management, energy efficiency, smart grids, those kinds of things. And the technology for energy storage is also getting much, much better. So all of those things are making the whole system much more complicated. There's also important emerging new markets for electricity. So it's not just that, you know, electricity demand is staying constant. There's a likelihood of really big new markets emerging. So key areas like transportation, electric vehicles are going to be very important over the next 20, 30 years. And also in areas like heating and cooling of buildings. So we have the emergence of sort of heat pumps as a very possibly very important way of heating and cooling buildings in the future. So the upshot of this is that, you know, traditional ways of doing planning just aren't going to work anymore. Utilities are at risk of losing their highest paying customers. So, and government, and on a sort of wider scale, governments are probably going to lose the ability to use energy systems to cross-subsidize one group of customers with another. You know, you just can't keep asking the higher paying customers to keep paying more because they're going to go off and make their own energy using solar power or whatever. And then we've got this sort of broader trend, which I'm sure most people in this room are fairly familiar with, I know my colleagues are, of, you know, we've really got a much better understanding now of the importance of air pollution and climate change. So there really is a need now for governments to step in and manage this process. And I'm just going to go into a few of those things in a little bit more detail. Whoops, a bit too much detail there, sorry. Whoa. Has got a mind of its own. I think that's the right one. Okay, so let's just unpack a couple of those things. So the first one is the emergence of renewable energy technologies, and those really are changing the game in a very dramatic way. Non-hydro renewable energy is increased by a factor of 7. Capacity for non-hydro renewable energy over the last 10 or so years. So enormous increases, and we're only just beginning to see that trend happening now. So, you know, if you think it's been an important trend so far, you ain't seen nothing yet, right? Because as prices come down, renewable energy is going to be extremely competitive with fossil-based energy in the coming 10, 20 years. Costs from solar modules fell 75%. I won't repeat all the statistics there. Similar, not quite as dramatic improvements in wind prices. And those are forecast to continue reducing in the future, partly as the technology gets better, as the wind turbines get larger and the capacity factors go up. That's all going to help drive down the price of wind power, and it's going to be very competitive. It already is very competitive in many situations, and that's just going to keep on coming. At the same time, the technologies that you need to complement your variable renewable energy, those are beginning to improve as well. So the prices for large-scale, utility-scale battery storage are coming down. They fell by 20% in 2014, and apparently fell by another 15% in 2015. So there's a, you know, really big improvement going on there. You get two for the price of one. At the same time, we've seen this trend of increased volatility in fuel prices. So that's very important, especially for oil importing or energy importing developing countries. But it's also important in even in countries that have large domestic resources. So we've seen countries like India, which are very dependent on coal. They've really suffered from the increased volatility in the price of the fuel. They've had to import much more of their coal recently. And bear in mind that this is an important issue because renewable energy technologies are really immune from this issue. And then there's the environmental imperative for change. So maybe I won't go deeply into this, but just to say, you know, we can talk about having climate change targets and low carbon futures. But let's not kid ourselves. The world is not reducing carbon emissions at the moment. Carbon emissions are growing by a couple of percent per year. The chart down at the bottom here shows you what we need to do. So this was done a while ago. So what we really need to be doing for some hope of keeping warming down to 2 degrees is to be on that red line there. So we need to be, you know, according to the best science, eliminating carbon emissions by 2040. And there's no way we're on a path to do that. At the same time, the issue of air pollution, we're beginning to understand that much more fully now. This chart at the top is from the Global Burden of Disease, and you can see that health issues related to air pollution are actually the 4th and 7th most important global issues in terms of global burden of disease. So air pollution from fossil fuels, which is a key part of that, is really vitally important. So those all tell us why we have to make dramatic changes to the system. It's not enough to just tinker around the edges. Okay, and developing countries are really not in a good position to deal with these challenges. So, you know, we have to address some fairly major challenges here, and we're not really ready to do that. So the kind of planning processes that are going on at the moment in the developing world really are not suitable for addressing the kind of detailed planning that needs to go on to take on these challenges. The data available in most countries is in very poor condition. We haven't been collecting data on technologies and energy services. Some of my colleagues here know what I'm talking about because they've just been trying to do that. And more broadly than that, we have very limited capacity in government agencies. So we don't really have the people we need to take on the challenge analytically. And the result of that is that most developing countries are highly reliant on foreign consultants to tell them what their energy policy should be. So we're not really in a position where developing countries can sort of set their own agendas for energy planning. The modeling tools available tend to be too expensive, too complex, and too data intensive. So we're really in quite a bad situation. So what can be done about this? Well, we require new approaches for integrated energy planning. We need approaches that are much more holistic, much more bottom-up and service-based. We need to take a scenario approach. So rather than trying to sort of do a single set of forecasts and do least cost planning, we need to take more of a scenario-based approach where we can identify robust solutions. We need to properly account for the impacts of efficiency, for the growth of renewable energy and storage. We need to fully consider environmental dimensions, so not just thinking about greenhouse gas emissions, but also thinking about the impacts of air pollution on human health, agriculture, and ecosystems. And we need to move away from this sort of technocratic approach where we trust our energy future to a sort of single planner to get it right. We need to have more people involved, because really the issue is about sort of what future do we want? What do we want our energy systems to look like? So we have to have broader conversations about these trends. So this is a huge challenge. You know, to do this is really expecting us to do something that's much more complex than the traditional planning. And even that's something that's a challenge in most developing countries. So really, there's a long-range agenda here. We need to build the capacity in agencies and governments and elsewhere to be able to do this kind of activity. Just a couple more slides. So what is SEI doing about this? Well, we're trying to make a small contribution on some of these issues. One of the things we've been doing is developing various modeling tools that are really based around this idea of doing sort of holistic integrated energy planning. In particular, there's a tool we've been developing for the last 25 or so years called LEAP, which is very much targeted at the needs of developing country planners. It's now being used in 190 countries, and we have thousands of users all over the world. We've been disseminating that tool for free to developing country organizations for more than 20 years. We also do a lot of work teaching the basic skills that are needed to do this kind of analysis. And then we've been fostering communities of practice to build planning capacity. We've also been working to advance the science on these issues. So a couple of things I'll mention that we've been doing recently, but just a couple I mentioned. One is we've been developing new tools to assess the human health and ecosystem impacts of energy scenarios. And we're also currently working on improving our tools so they're much better able to think about some of these emerging issues, for example, like what kind of levels of storage are you going to need if you're going to have very high penetration of variable renewables. Okay, so that's basically what we've been doing. Just to give you a quick hint, here's some of the screenshots of the software we put out there. It's called LEAP. And if you're interested in knowing more about what we're doing, you know, please visit the website here. We already have over 30,000 members on this website. So it really is a community of practice of people thinking about energy policy in the developing world. So please come and visit. And I'll leave it to that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And here's a small gift.
Thank you very much.
Yes. And now we will have a coffee break. We are a few minutes behind the schedule, just a few. So can we come also 5 minutes later from the coffee break? And and continue at 3:45. Yes. Okay. So use that time for discussing and taking coffee, and we'll see 3:45.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Ready now to move on with the program, to move on to the speed talk section in our seminar. My name is Helen Saanid and I am the marketing and communication manager for the Stockholm Environment Institute Tallinn Center, SEI Tallinn. And today at the speed talk section, we have planned a series of presentations, about 7 minutes each, after which we have planned a question or two from the audience. And unfortunately, we had a cancellation this morning. Our colleague from SEI Stockholm fell ill and was not able to travel to Tallinn, but we will move on with the program as planned. So I am very happy to ask my colleague from SEI Tallinn, Kaja Peterson, to come up on stage. Kaja is a program director and senior researcher for SEI Tallinn, but in addition, she's also the chairwoman for the Sustainable Development Commission, which is working under the Estonian government office. And for example, a year ago, Kaja went to New York to the UN Sustainable Development Summit, where the SDGs were adopted for the first time. And Kaja was part of the Estonian delegation. So she's very much an expert on the SDGs and how Estonia is performing in this sector. And her talk today will be concentrating precisely on that. SDGs relating to energy and climate and the Estonian performance. So please, Kaja, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Helen. I already got the applause as an advantage and as a promotion. So thank you for that. Since we are performing a speed talk, I think it's not just speaking quickly, but perhaps speaking the messages and to getting through the not very many messages, but some of them. So as to the SDGs, as we all know, and as Helen was also referring last September, we also introduced a new metrics, which is Sustainable Development Goals, which will be the common goals until 2030 all over the world. And formerly, when the climate and energy wasn't in the Millennium Development Goals as explicitly as they are now in the global goals for sustainable development. However, there are maybe all the 17 goals can be said they are all energy related, starting from the hunger or poverty issues or even going through the ecosystems or consumption and production issues till the very last ones concerning the partnerships and governance issues. But there are two SDGs that are explicitly addressing the energy agenda, number 7, which is a renewable energy, or also some have said that this is more an access to energy and access to renewable energy. And the number 13, which is about climate change or climate action issues. So there are maybe two more energy and climate focused objectives. This is a small figure, but just to give an overview where Estonia stands or stood last year when first such an overview of the implementation of the SDGs in the OECD countries was first published. And again, looking at the number 7 and number 13, for Estonia, the climate action is all red, which means that this is something like the traffic lights that we should be very concerned about, while the energy issues, the goal number 7, there is one red and one green indicator. So this is very much about the indicators, what we can take on board. Usually they are measuring the CO2 emissions from fuel combustion or per GDP. Also the energy intensity is an issue and the share of renewable energy. Again, when we look back, what has Estonia been among different performance indicators, then climate and energy, according to the Yale Environmental Performance Index, again shows that Estonia is performing not very well in terms of climate and energy portfolio, and ranking has even decreased in a way that Estonia is lagging behind. There is always this dilemma of being energy secure and also to conserve the environment. This was also touched upon early this morning in the presentations, that whether we should be choosing energy security or how to also not to harm the environment. And there is also a third dimension, the energy equity, which places Estonia relatively in a high position. But again, as you can see from the security point of view and especially from the sustainability point of view, is not in a very good position. And surprisingly, or not so surprisingly, also according to the ecological footprint based on the 2012 data, it shows that Estonia is almost using 4 times more global hectares per person in order to bufferize all the environmental impact compared to the global medium, the average, which is 1.7 global hectares. The most recent SDG index that was just published this summer, it also shows that as far as Estonia is concerned, the climate action is in red. But as you can see, it always depends on the measurement. And here, the Sustainable Development Solutions Network has put the energy-related CO2 emissions per capita as in the red zone, but also the climate change vulnerability monitor data. In the energy access and renewable energy SDG, that we are still lacking behind the other countries, but not in the red zone. Well, last year we also, Estonian Ministry for Environment, conducted an overview or just asked the people's opinion of experts and different public civil servants, which SDGs would be the most important for Estonia. And here is just the first 5 SDGs that were regarded as the most important ones. Education, consumption, the 3rd and 4th place was shared by energy and biodiversity issues, and health came as the 5th area. So energy is very important, but not as perceived as the most important issue. Of course, we should take into account this is among the 17 SDGs. So what is the way forward? And it has also been emphasized in the previous presentations today as well, that there should be a very strong governmental commitment how to deal with our curse and blessing, so to speak, the oil shale, Põlevkivi. And referring back to some other exits, I'm also have introduced a Brexit term that we should start planning and really very seriously looking at it, not only from the energy and the resource perspective, but also from the social perspective. Because this governmental decision that was described in the early panel was exactly that there was no plan B thought of what to do if the oil price would drop as low as it is today. And certainly there are serious questions that to be addressed concerning the transport energy intensity and also the housing issue, as it was also emphasized by the previous Minister for Environment, that housing is an issue and there is a considerable room for improvement. But these two issues, transport and housing, will be shortly discussed by my two of my colleagues. So thank you for the attention.
Thank you very much, Kaja. I think Brexit is an excellent term and I hope it will go viral and you can all share it after this seminar. But now, are there any questions to Kaja from the audience? If not, Kaja, I would like to ask you, in your talk you were concentrating on SDGs relating to energy and climate, but then again, SDGs are very much interlinked. They have an intersectoral and cross-governance nature. So in Estonia, who is or should be in charge of the full implementation of SDGs in our country?
Yeah, as you already said, yeah, it is very interlinked and intersectorial issue. So it shouldn't be just a matter of one minister or two or three ministers. It should be the whole government. And since from the Estonian administrative structure, I would see that the office, the government office, could be the most appropriate place for that, because this is where all the different sectoral plans and the linkages between the plans and issues are discussed and are continuously on the table. So yeah, I would suggest that it should be at the governmental level.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Kaja. One question from Valdur, please.
What do you think, would Estonia benefit cooperating with the other Baltic Sea countries on implementing sustainable development goals or not?
Mm. Of course, I think cooperation is always good. Just to have the same issues on the table and to learn from the others and share practices, and I think this is very important that Estonia is will be at the table. I somehow feel where you pointed with your question. Yes, currently, yeah, Estonia has taken a reserved position at the Council for Baltic Sea States in the expert group for sustainable development. I agree that with those who think that yes, Estonia should be at the table there.
Yes, please, Lauri.
When I was in Stockholm visiting the SEI Stockholm office, then that was the Minister of Public Affairs, or what's the correct name? Yeah. So and it was surprising to me that he was in charge of actually really and responsible for the sustainable development goals, and there was a kind of lots of tools and work towards helping municipalities and local administrations to integrate and take responsibility. Do you see that there's potential in Estonia also, that local governments could take a stronger role in this issue. Does it resonate at all with them, or is it after the local government reform that they pick up the phone on this issue?
Yeah, the local governments, I think, are very important. And when I was reviewing the voluntary national reports to the UN High-Level Political Forum, and then I also observed that most of the countries also stressed that there is a very, very big importance to have those SDGs at the national or federal level, but also at the local government level. And but I think from what I am suggesting is that first there should be a very strong political commitment at the government level, and then this should be transferred or transposed also to the local level. But yeah, you are right. I think nothing will happen if the local governments will not be on board.
Thank you very much, Kaja. And here's a little gift for you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And now we are ready to move on with the presentations. I'm very glad to introduce my colleague Kerli Kirisima, junior expert at SEI Tallinn, and she will be telling us about the Estonian housing sector and energy efficiency measures for the housing sector, which is a topic, a very important and interesting topic that is affecting most of us here in Estonia. So please, Kerli.
Thank you, Helen, for this description. My name is Kerli. And as Kaja said, that we are in Estonia lacking behind in the energy and climate program, then I will be going more specific and talking about the possibilities, what we could do in Estonia in order to improve the energy sector. And I start my slides with my key message that renovation is the key to the energy efficient housing in Estonia. And I will be now further on speaking why. Is it like that? So my presentation is based on a project that I've been working on within the last 1 year. And the name of the project is HERO, for all the new building stock. So my business as usual scenario turned out that the future is not that bad, because you could tell that it's only growing 2% the consumption, where we are standing now and where we would reach 2030. However, future is not that bad, but it could be better. Because it could be better depending on what you compare it with. And I compared my results with the EU targets, what is not only Estonia, but also other EU countries need to achieve by 2030. So according to this, we still miss a lot from our baseline in order to reach the targets. And for that reason, I also worked on two different energy efficiency scenarios. And probably many of you in the audience are very well known about the National Energy Development Plan up to 2030. So my work is actually based on the same assumptions what were worked on during this development plan scenario analysis. So the first scenario that I looked at is called the minimally intervening state energy efficiency scenario, which means that, as I described before, my business as usual scenario is already taking into account the fact that the new buildings to be built comply with already quite a high energy standards. So really the key to focus is the current housing stock, where we could implement renovation parameters. And so my first scenario has less ambitious parameters than the one on my next slide. And according to this scenario, state would give out about 25% of funding to renovate the current housing stock. And according to that scenario, we would still actually miss 13% from the target. So that's why I also worked on a second efficiency scenario, would have more ambitious renovation funds given out by the government. And instead of 25%, the government would be as friendly as give out 35%. And according to that scenario, it looks like we would even be 8% better from the target. But as I said before, it really depends what you compare it with. And as the last target was is based on the scenario what was worked out in 2007, then at this time there were no minimum energy performance requirements what Estonia has to now comply with. So really the key is that the more you invest, the more you achieve. And if you fly to Tallinn, you probably flew over one of those districts where our main problem relies. So in Tallinn, there are like Lasnamägi and Mustamägi, where a lot of panel buildings. And this is where also one of the key problems is that these houses are, there's loads of those houses what needs energy improvements. And I hope that we could get there soon. Thank you.
Are there any questions for Kerli about housing? Yes, please, Johan.
Thanks, a really interesting presentation. Just a question, when you talk about these energy efficiency programs and you also show this last picture, which of course is certainly in areas where there might be also economic challenges and so on, what kind of discussions do you have in terms of financing energy efficiency? Even though you may gain eventually because of lower energy consumption, but how do you finance these programs in Estonia? What's the idea behind that?
Well, in Estonia, we actually have this beautiful foundation called CredEx, which is now working pretty well because all the apartment associations are applying more and more for this funding, what they give out. And my the best ambitious scenario was based on the fact that now they have like this scheme that they the funding is really project based, so it really depends about the building project, and depending on that, how much funding will be given out. But then there is the possibility actually or potential if according to this scenario there are no other, let's say, sectors where the government would focus on, and they really would focus on the housing sector, then there would be this potential to fund more.
Thank you. Any other questions for Kerli? Because I would like to ask, renovation, you mentioned renovation is the key to energy efficiency for the Estonian housing sector, but what other measures or policies could our country, could the state implement to increase the efficiency?
Well, in parallel with the renovation funding, there is also demolition allowance, which would be given out. So there are a lot of houses which are could be demolished, because they also actually increased the graph of energy consumption in a way. And also there would be, of course, pilot projects for nearly zero energy houses, especially done or initiated by the government. So the governmental pilot projects. Then also awareness raising in order to assure that all the nearly zero energy houses will be built in a correct way. And so the legislations should be changed, and also the planning documents so that we could require carbon dioxide assessments for the buildings. So really a list of measures.
So thank you very much, Kerli. Thank you. And I will ask my colleague, Mari Jussi, to join now. And yes, there's a little gift for you. Kerli, thank you. Thanks. So Mari is a senior expert on concentrating on sustainable transport policies, and that's what she will be looking at during her presentation also. So energy efficient solutions for the Estonian transport sector for 2030.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I will go straight on my slides. So actually the project that Kelly mentioned, so this most of this research that I've done for this presentation is also related to the Heron project funded by Horizon 2020. And in the transport sector, the key research question was that what are the policy measures that can deliver our national energy efficiency and climate policy targets by 2030? And what are the key barriers for the energy efficient transport system in Estonia? But I'm focusing rather on the policy measures. And we did the analysis, or it's still ongoing work, so we also used LEAP tool to analyze these policy measures in different scenarios. So what are the current trends in energy consumption in transport? Transport is like a quarter of the final energy demand is in the transport sector, and it's one of the few sectors where the demand for energy is still growing. And with this business as usual current trends, until 2030 there would be no change in the growth of the energy demand in transport. And the key drivers in this growth for demand are drivers. So it's basically the car use that is driving this driving this trend for increasing demand, and also currently the low oil prices. And what are the same problem as Charlie had? And we also asked many experts in Estonia, like 30, 50 experts, what do they think that are the key barriers for this kind of trends in Estonia? And besides this word cloud that was generated with these names of barriers, the two key barriers are lack of integrated planning in the transport sector and spatial planning, and that current fiscal instruments in the transport sector in Estonia are not encouraging fuel efficient transport patterns. So we just for our foreign guests to let you know that we have basically only fuel excise duty in the transport sector, no whatsoever vehicle taxation. This is when you look out on the streets in Estonia, in Tallinn, so you might see a lot more bigger cars than elsewhere. And actually also what's the problem is that it's not just the existing car fleet that is not so fuel efficient, but that the new cars that are purchased in Estonia are the least fuel efficient ones in Europe. So looking at these possible alternative scenarios, we can see that there is a great potential for energy saving in the transport sector. And this is a factor that's also increasingly recognized by the national policy processes like the energy strategy and the climate roadmap 2050. But what are the measures that actually can deliver this downward trend? So I'm just putting here the measures that have the highest potential. And first, like I said, it's the fuel efficient vehicles that could deliver the highest potential in fuel efficiency until 2030. Then integrated urban planning. So it's dealing with the demand for transport and car dependence. Third is freight demand management, that we have a high increase in the road transport sector, and with smart road pricing we could manage this demand there. Then next one is invest in public transport and active modes, so that the alternatives could be more attractive for the users. Then eco-driving, traffic calming, so that's to reduce this kind of aggressive style of driving can also deliver energy saving. So, and now when we compared it to the national targets in terms of CO2 emissions by 2030, so with the effort-sharing decision target of minus 13% compared to 2005 levels, so we see that it's quite a challenging target for Estonia. And we need to take into account and really implement all these measures to be able to achieve these targets by 2030. So the 2020 targets that still allow us to increase the emissions, it seems quite realistic that Estonia is going to deliver these targets, but not for 2030. And just to say that many changes are starting from the head, let's say, and maybe in 2 years, when you go out from this building, the picture on the street will look like that. This is currently the plan in by Tallinn City and also supported by the national government to redesign the main street of Tallinn. It's a stretch of 3 to 4 kilometers just in front of this hotel and from to the left and to the right. And this is a good example that there is will and good examples for changes in this policy making. But Kate Bentus-Rosimannus says that we shouldn't give too many mixed signals in this transport policy either. So on the other hand, we have this Main Street plan here happening. But on the other side of the building, there is a Rady Road, Rady Street and Road development scheme that would put 6 to 8 lanes of cars between the sea and the city. So many old policies are still have a very strong inertia, and this needs to be changed. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mari. Any questions for Mari? Yes, Valdur, go ahead.
I apologize, but I waited unless there was no questions then. Our government is exceptionally good implementing policy measures which encourage energy efficient vehicles penetration by increasing the fuel tax, raising the fuel price, and every car driver thinks of looking for the more efficient car because the fuel cost is increasing year by year. But the car drivers are also those who vote every 4 years for the new parliament, the parties there. How this contradiction is in Estonia reflected that the consumers are fighting against the incentives and the government is then fighting between those different, one is the target to get car-free cities and a carbon, low-carbon transport, and the other target to get voted, elected into the parliament and the government.
Thank you, Aldo. Well, first there, we have analyzed also that this hasn't been very an efficient method to increase the fuel excise duty to reach these targets. So it's just the consumers don't notice it, even especially combined with increasing economic or the purchasing power of the people, and also that the oil prices are going down. So actually the consumers currently are not noticing the increase in the excise duty. And also it's true that the current government has also promised in their platform for the 4 years that they will not implement any vehicle-based taxation whatsoever. But I think it seems that government is sort of melting in this field, that it's already taking now the issue of the company cars and how much you can actually deduct from your taxes when you are driving a company car. So the current government is, I hope so, it's more open to the new and more efficient taxation issues. And it's not only the national government, of course, that has to be responsible for that, but it's also the cities, because it's many of the solutions and measures that I mentioned actually have to happen in the local municipalities and in the cities. And the voters are not all drivers, and the drivers also are pedestrians. Some part of the day, their grannies are using public transport. So it's just, I think it's a media bubble that we just only drive everywhere, and it would be a harassing of the personal rights.
Yes, one more question.
I can't say it's a question or not, but in fact, probably one of the measures can be if we restore back the normal public transport, because at the moment in a lot of the rural areas, it's not existing at all. And we can pick up the taxes on the fuel, but it means only that the people will leave these areas and will be concentrated in the cities.
Yes.
Yeah, and also that our research also proposes more smart measures for taxation, not just this kind of static ones that would be kilometer-based charging, which is more concentrated on the cities, and not posing these taxes on the rural areas. So fuel duty is enough for the rural areas, let's say, but the new fiscal measures should be more around the congested and these kind of regions where you have alternatives for public transport and shorter distances to be covered by bicycle.
Thank you very much, Mari. A little gift for you. Thank you. And now we are ready to move on to our panel discussion, so I will pass on the moderation and the microphone to Lauri.
Yes.
Please.
And thank you very much, Helen.
Thank you.
A round of applause. So, I'm really pleased. Let me see the topic, what we promised to deliver. So we promised that there will be a discussion on low carbon energy system, new practical steps and financing solutions. Don't know about the practical steps, but definitely that will be about financing solutions. So it is my absolute pleasure to welcome here to discuss this matter. First, Mr. Alan Pollock, SEI board member, but also a CEO of a big pension fund from Denmark. Also very long standing experience in banking and asset management. So a warm welcome, Alan. And secondly, great pleasure to also welcome here Dr. Steven Litter, also our board member, but having very, very extensive experience across the globe in advising governments, in helping out with setting up financing solutions from different sectors, most notably water and infrastructure and other areas, and also visiting professor at King's College London. So, welcome. And finally, also representing Estonia, a man also with very various experiences, having worked in commercial bank, but also having worked in EBRD, one of the big players in financing these related areas, and now very recently also stepped into the pension games, founder of People's Pension Fund Tuleva. So Tõnu Pekk, welcome. Having such a diverse group of people around the table here, so maybe it would be nice to really understand and create some common ground that please just make a small tour of table and explain, you know, if you're talking about green financing, what are you talking about and what's your interest in this area? So maybe we'll start from here, Stephen.
Well, first of all, it's a pleasure to be here in Estonia and have an opportunity to talk about this issue, having worked in Estonia quite a bit in my past, particularly when I was with the World Bank. It's a pleasure to see a number of colleagues I worked with quite closely on the energy sector and also on the environmental questions more broadly in the Baltic Sea. I think this morning we really started out very well because we had two really key things put on the table in that first discussion with the current minister and the previous minister, and they're really related to the whole question we're here to talk about. And that is the most critical shift is a shift in mindset. How we think about things is the real basis to make this transition. And I would argue, I have an optimistic background. That's what you see people involved in multilateral development banks and bilateral development organizations having an optimistic background. I think we are now making that mind shift. And I'll talk about that a bit. Secondly, we also have to realize we've got challenges. And these challenges involve contradictions. Estonia is one of the most advanced economies. In many ways, it's an intellectual center of innovation. It's incredible what's happened here in the last 25 years. But you have a challenge. Everyone's been very open about it. You've got a big program for renewables. You have a tremendous amount of renewable energy resources here. And you still have what to do with the reliability and security of your supply, which ties you back into the whole question of what to do with oil shale, which clearly will be discussed for the next several days in the parallel conference that's happening. So when one looks at this, what do you do in reality? What we're in now is a transition. If you look at what's happening with the multilateral development banks and the bilateral development organizations, you're seeing very, very rapid mobilization of financial resources to support climate change with energy transition folded into that. There's about $25 billion a year now that are being put forward by the various large multilateral development banks, and that's growing. Many of them are setting targets. But that is possible because the governments and the private sector have chosen to change their approach and are also requesting on demand that investments be made. So I think what we're seeing is motion. I think what's also important is we just had the G20 summit hosted by China. Many people look at the sustainable development goals, they look at the Paris Agreement. But I think the G20 summit hosted by China is very important because that's where the major report of the G20 Green Finance Study Group was made. And that report very much focuses on how do we really mobilize funding on a voluntary basis for voluntary actions. If you look at what's happened with the Sustainable Development Goals and the Paris Agreement, there's a lot of focus on voluntary decisions, voluntary identification of what to do to move forward. And that voluntary approach is something we saw embraced in G20. So this has had a big roll-on effect with China and other developing economies, major developing economies, stepping up and joining. Underlying this is a view that one of the major instruments will be green bonds, which I think my two colleagues are much better placed than I to discuss.
Okay, thank you very much. Tuno, Stephen was mentioning the voluntary aspect. I think it resonates with you.
It's actually great, thanks that you just brought it to a level. I was already afraid a little bit that you started at such a high level of the discussion that I am not qualified to comment on a global agreements. But the reason I'm probably here was I had a chance this beginning of this year to work with Environmental Investment Center with Lauri and his colleagues devising ways how the Estonian government's agency can use their money better for supporting green finance and energy efficiency. And already prior to that, I have always had the feeling, sort of in looking at the recent developments in the market, that there are, you know, two great obstacles now coming up the way of green finance and energy efficiency. One is that, you know, just looking around, you see that a lot of stuff has been done. So the easy, you know, apartment blocks, you know, the outer walls being kind of insulated, you know, perhaps even windows changed. And that's one, so the, probably that's the, these were the easy gains. You know, they also, you know, probably for the cost of paint already, or they're gonna have the benefit of having a nicer appearance, they paid for themselves. And the second thing is obviously the all oil and energy and gas price, the natural gas prices have fallen 30, 50, even perhaps more percent. So so kind of in your, I'm an Excel person, so then in my model, obviously, the hurdle goes much higher. So and together with the Environmental Investment Center, we then we looked, you know, basically had a chance to brainstorm together with them. We visited several foreign institutions who deal with green finance, like EBRD, EIB, Green Investment Bank, several private, like Bridges Ventures, etc. Also in Estonia, discussed with the people who actually are supposed to kind of employ these funds, and basically came to, you know, more or less two conclusions. That one is that, you know, despite that it's getting harder and it's, you know, perhaps less profitable, it's still, all these projects are business projects, so that, that, you know, eventually they pay for it themselves. And so given from that, you know, one, what the government should or the government, we found that perhaps given it's, again, it's even though, you know, some projects longer, some projects shorter payback time, they still pay themselves back in most cases, not in all, but in most cases. And so that we could stretch the about 50 million program, the government grant, into at least 120 million investment program with the help of loans, for example. We looked at, you know, more complicated instruments like the ESCOs, etc. But I think the conclusion we came to that you don't even have to be EIB type, very kind of, you know, financial engineering guru to do sort of like public-private participation projects. You know, even a simple combination of grants and loans would do. So I hope Estonian Investment Central will implement some of the projects, and you know, probably it helps to kind of shape the mindset as well in when they set new policies. And you know, as Lauri mentioned, in my new role as mobilizing Estonian pension savings, I see also from the, you know, from our members' side that there is a demand for long-term investment projects. And you know, this, which should be also taken into account, that people, I think it wouldn't be wrong for them to wish that part of their long-term savings were somehow directly aligned to the well-being of their kind of environment. And so the government should make, you know, when they invest some of their money into the project, in a business projects of supporting green energy and energy efficiency, then they should always make room for pension funds as well, because that's what people want. Thank you.
Alan, so I think it's really a good time for you to step in and say that, is it a hot topic for you? Is it the shareholders, do they want this? Is it, you know, are you looking at these international kind of agreements and political things, or it's a business case, or it's a combination?
Yeah. Now, there has not been a miracle, so it's still so that investors won't return. Mm. That has not changed. But there, something has changed, because if you just look at the development, it's pretty fantastic. I mean, last year was the first year when there was invested more in renewable capacity than in the old world capacity. That's fantastic. So despite that, it will take us until 2030 before actually CO2 emission has peaked. So, but there is a change. So why is this change there? And I think there are three drivers, and we should use those drivers now, because there's an open window now. It might close again. So let's look at these three drivers. One is, that has already been said, particularly by Charlie, the technology. Now, technology has changed in such a fantastic way that now you can actually, even without substitution, you can even get business cases now where, at least in some parts of the world, you can get solar energy and you can get wind energy without governments having to put extra money to support this. And that's, of course, fantastic. You couldn't do that a couple of years ago. Now, even in areas like UK, for instance, you can now start to build solar farms. Now, there are still some government money supported behind it, but it has improved a lot. And you can expect that in the next 2 to 3 years, it will improve even further. So technology is really supporting us here. Then secondly, and that's from an investment point of view extremely important, what about the alternative? Now, the alternative is that we invest our money in what we call bonds and fixed income, and the return on that has gone into zero. Not even low, but zero. And what happens, and that's the whole purpose of this monetary policy, that is that people like Tory and me, we have to move to put money somewhere else. And then we look for excess return somewhere. And this excess return that you can obtain in some of these, let's say, environmental friendly investments are actually becoming attractive. So before you might say, okay, 4-5% was not attractive, now it starts to become attractive. And that's a fantastic driver. The last driver is that in private investments, now we can talk about government investment, but private investments, you actually see that there are single persons behind, and they are interested. It is true that they want to optimize the return, but they want to do it in, and I call it in a responsible way. They do actually want to earn clean returns, so to speak. And you can still optimize your return in a decent way. And that's an enormous change in behavior among investors. That they actually want the business models to be sustainable. And that requires, from an energy point of view, that it is pretty clean energy, renewable energy, behind whatever business models you have. So there is a really important change going on, and I think we should do whatever we can to support that change, because there is this open window right now.
But talking about the green bonds, I mean, it's also, well, requires a certain level of sophistication in terms of and regulatory environment and offering. So do you see, is it something that will, you know, there's the Juncker package and green bonds in Europe developing fast, and look, rather it seems that there is more money kind of waiting and looking for projects than actually projects to be financed. But does it create kind of inequality, or does it support more the advanced economies? Or is it relevant also in transition and developing economies?
Well, I can start at least. But you could say green bonds is a buzzword. I mean, it's just something you call it to gain some interest, etc. There is no clear definition. World Bank has started to put up a definition, but there's no criteria. If you breach this definition, you can still divest it or distribute it as a green bond. So, but the important thing is that there's a bond, which is a loan. And then you can, that's one kind of investment. And the other one is actually that you own the project, you own the field, the wind field or the wind farm, or you own the solar plant, etc. So there's ownership and loans. That's important. In all these green bond loans, there are very often a kind of guarantee behind somewhere. So governments are not gone totally away. Quite often they are in with some kind of guarantee. Mm-hmm. And that is complicated, because sometimes the guarantee is not done by the government, but by a government-owned unit. And because a unit, a company, is owned by a government, it doesn't mean that it cannot go bankrupt. It can. So you have a very interesting idea who is actually behind these bonds. But that's a bond where you basically get your 4.5% and that's it. Then you have, which is maybe more interesting, is that you can actually buy entire units. You can buy a windmill production unit. And then you make an agreement with a utility company, and they, and here comes the important thing, they guarantee a minimum price for a pretty long period, often 15, 20 years, that despite the world price of energy, you can expect to get this return. So what does it actually mean? It means that governments commit for the future. It doesn't cost money right now, but it costs commitment for the future. And this is this interesting thing. Does that go on the balance sheet of governments? Sometimes not. But they have committed for the future. And that's why there is a political risk in this, which can be debated. But this is how it works. So there are, you will always have some kind of government influential into this.
Stephen, how do you see it? Green bonds, a buzzword, or is this green financing somehow replacing, complementing, or it's actually the same that intergovernmental banks and organizations have been doing? To see an actual content change there?
Okay, I think there are two issues here. One is green bonds something that's being discussed but not well defined? I believe it is being widely discussed and not well defined. However, there are structures within the international system, be it the initiative of the World Bank that was just being spoken about, or the work of this G20 working group, which the World Bank's heavily involved in, as well as the major European financial institutions, to try to come up with a definition and a characterization of what is a green bond. So there's no doubt people are seeing this as a way forward. What form it will take will continue to evolve. But clearly this is a term that's being used, but it's like sustainable development. There's a continuum, but I think in this case it's going to have to be defined because it's an instrument that's going to be used financially. So it's evolving. Then you've got the question of the investment programs, the more classic ones financed, let's say, by the World Bank, the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, European Investment Bank, Asian Development Bank, or the two new banks in Asia, the New Development Bank or the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. If you look at those lending portfolios of all those organizations, they've got a lot more work where they're looking at energy generation, which is more friendly, conservation being heavily invested in because you get good returns on conservation, issues of supporting renewables, issues of supporting integration. You heard about that in the discussions earlier today. How do you integrate the energy system so you've got greater flexibility? So now, if you look at the current investment programs, they don't look like the kind you had 10, 15, 20 years ago. They actually look different. And then going back to the discussion we had earlier this afternoon about energy planning, I think that's where the gap is. The energy planning is a real challenge. Historically, what you did is you did optimization investment models. The WASP model was the one the World Bank used to use. And as Charlie described it, it said how many power plants you're going to need, how many hydro facilities, and then you'd come up with a mix and you'd use that to generate the investment programming. It's much, much more complicated. In some countries, developed, emerging market economies and developing countries have various skill levels and various ways to meet this challenge. So I would say the investment patterns are changing, but the planning patterns are changing, but there's a big gap on the planning side that needs to be addressed. And that's going to make it very interesting for all the professionals in this room. There's plenty of work to do in the future.
From the experience I'm now having with the People's Pension Fund and talking to not really the retail investors who are investing long-term in various projects. I come to the, perhaps it's inappropriate, the comparison, but defining green bond, probably it's complicated. But on the other hand, it's like with this US judge who was looking at the definition of porn and says that, I know when I see it, so like, and I think for most people, when they see something which is a green bond, they will recognize it, you know, definition or not. And for them, you know, perhaps, you know, again, I'm speculating here, a bond issued by, for example, an Estonian energy company, you know, with the pictures of these ash mountains in the region where I come from, you know, maybe doesn't quite, you know, even if it fits the definition, it might not in their portfolio, it wouldn't qualify as a green bond. But also, you know, it's just a hypothesis, but I somehow, I got the feeling that if the people have a choice, you know, personally, okay, they see two bonds, you know, perhaps even with an equal interest rate or maybe not a big difference, they would just prefer something which they would presume is green. And if that choice is made to people, if actually they have a real possibility to choose, then maybe we would have more green finance. You know, maybe people actually you know, if you ask them what kind of return you want from your pension fund, and they, you know, type into this calculator and look, you know, it needs to be 5%. If they have a choice again, like, so where, you know, where do you want me to put your pension money now? Like, is it kind of truly like a green project, or is it this kind of, you know, burning ash mountain? So then they would say, oh yeah, fine, put it in the green project. So, and they would adjust their return expectations accordingly. Maybe it's not that simple how it works, but I think the people, they would be content with lower yield on something which they kind of feel is truly green. Hmm.
But we've talked a lot about bonds here and multinational banks and so on, but you know, we have companies offering green products, we have consumers wanting organic something, whatever it is. If it's organic, they want it. But for example, why don't we see commercial banks offering kind of green loans, dedicated products? In your work, have you seen that there is discussion, there is the trend of dedicated, you know, green or energy efficiency credit lines coming out, or it's not an issue?
No, I can try at least to answer it. There are different players in the market. You basically have the private sector with commercial banks, and you have savings funds and some pension fund, life companies are also private, and you have what the public is doing. So if you, and of course that's a more governmental priority, but if you look at the banks are under a new regulation now, which is very tough, which is called Basel rules. And the Basel rules, they require that if you do a long-term loan to someone who has not got a top rating at the rating agency, then it costs you a lot of capital to give that money out. You have to put that equity capital aside. And then in order to pay that equity capital, the return on that, the rate on the loan will be ridiculously high. So that market doesn't exist, not just because they don't want, but it simply becomes too expensive. Then it makes much more sense to ask the long-term savers, which are in investment funds, it's pension companies and life insurance companies. Can you provide some long-term financing for these renewable projects? And the answer, as we talked about, is becoming yes, they will. So banks can organize a loan, but they can't open their treasuries and start to give you money.
Or only if there would be some sort of public guarantee on these instruments.
Yeah, I mean, that's a different story then. If there's a guarantee, it costs less on the capital. But then you miss a bit the point if you have to use the situation where that's the difference where what I call a commitment, which is better done on the price, where you commit the price of energy, etc. because that doesn't have to go to the balance sheet of the government.
I mean, one of the things you really see, and this is part of what this G20 process has been so profoundly focused on, is there's a finite amount of public money which is going to be put up, whether it's being administered by the Green Climate Fund, whether it's being administered by the multilateral banks, bilateral donors. It's still public funds, and they're using those to leverage lending or to leverage grants. And then you're also getting, in the case of the multilateral banks, guarantees from the government for repayment. Now, as it occurs, whether you're an Estonian or whether you're an American, whether you're Danish, there's just a finite amount of money taxpayers can put up for international types of programs. And so what people are saying is, how do we get the private sector in voluntarily, and how do we also get these funding groups, like was just being discussed, the pension funds, these type of parties, to play a bigger role in this, so you've got a bigger financial base in order to undertake these. And that's why it's an exciting development, but it's also one that's going to go on for 4 or 5 years, at least before it totally stabilizes and it's clear. So there's great innovation, which is fabulous, but also it's something which will be continuously redefined, I think, as we go forward in the next few years.
But maybe I can bring the example from, again, from our discussions and with the Estonian Environmental Investment Agency. So we discovered that there's, on the micro level, again, on kind of just a small, you know, small, medium enterprises, there is actually plenty of energy efficiency investment, et cetera, energy saving that can be done. But, you know, companies have plenty of other stuff to do as well. And it's still even, you know, for most of the companies, it's not the top priority for people. So you need kind of some incentive to bring it up. At the same time, you know, the banks would be, you know, in many cases willing also to, you know, perhaps to fund such projects, you know, if company has just overall acceptable credit. But again, we're talking about companies here which actually, you know, never reach rating agencies. So therefore, from the Basel perspective, they're all the same, you know, same type of companies, same capital charge. And we thought about this, you know, perhaps, you know, even just a sticker would help, you know, if we would kind of set up the terms which kind of qualify a loan, a green loan, for example, and which, you know, banks, they, you know, in preliminary discussions looked interested that it's very good to say that, you know, okay, we are giving out green loans. And so, you know, if you define a list, so of activities that can be funded with that, you know, perhaps give in, you know, some small prize as well in terms of like some kind of voucher for doing that kind of project, you know, voucher again, I mean, some money, some grant, then you could avoid this, you know, that there wouldn't be any excess charge. So the banks would be still doing the same thing what they do, but the companies would be presented with two options. One is doing the old way, and the other one is doing the kind of green way, and you know, maybe wouldn't cost extra, you know, perhaps the small government voucher which would be added to this project. It would make the project a little bit more expensive, you know, maybe because it's done in a green way. But the companies would be willing to do it. So I mean, would be interesting to see if this if this thing gets implemented in at the Estonian Investment Environmental Agencies.
As we are getting closer to 5 o'clock, which means we would have to end, then I just wanted your kind of concluding view or your personal take. We've seen global Estonian regional in all of the countries that are very high ambitious plans. What's your view? Will we run out of money or projects, financiable projects? Which are we lacking at the moment, or will we deliver smoothly all of it that is being in those plans?
I would say people here have a tremendous imagination. They're able to innovate, and they're able to adapt. So for a country like Estonia, I think you're going to do very well. For countries that have less flexibility and less vision and less pragmatism, it's going to be a bigger challenge because here, you know, you've already heard there are small projects going to be done. We heard about the housing. I've seen that housing a number of times. There are a lot of things you can do. So in Estonia, you've got policy interventions and investment actions that are manageable within the context of the country. So in many ways, if you take the oil shale challenge off the table, most of the other things here are doable through a sustained commitment and through a willingness and ability to continuously adjust how you're dealing with this. That's my view.
Okay, Tõnu.
Yeah, looking at the printing press, then the money certainly doesn't seem to doesn't seem to end. Yes, but yeah, obviously the question is, you know, if the willingness at some point runs out, you know, I hope not. And in that sense, I agree with Stephen that Estonia is in a great place because it is not that many middle layers between, you know, the actual people and who are kind of benefit from a better environment and the decision makers. So I do really hope that, and also it takes a very little, you know, just, you know, if we just change the decision not to invest into next oil shale power plant, then we already turn this balance, I don't know, 100%.
Okay, Alan.
Yeah, I think you will have what I call micro level and macro level. Now, on micro level, I totally agree a lot of interesting things has been done and will be done because this is a very creative country. Now, at macro level, I think you have to look at some of the other countries around Estonia because you could say in, let's say, the country where I come from, Denmark and the UK, the sun is not shining almost there. And hydro energy we don't have because we are flat, like Estonia is flat. So what do we do? And there has been a long-term commitment to renewables and to these huge transitions. So now, for instance, in Denmark, we will most likely this year pass that 50% of energy will come from renewables. That's a pretty high number. So with these long-term commitments, things can be done. The most advanced country in Europe in this is the UK. They have actually done quite a lot. The first projects costed the government a lot of money, too much. But now they have actually found an equilibrium in how much actually to commit. And I think it's about getting out on the learning curve. Do some projects, learn from it, and then you do another one.
Okay, thank you. It's a pity that we have to end here, but at least we had 40 very good minutes. And we will also have actually the buffet, as I said, to continue with this discussion. So thank you. I will have also a small bag for you. Thank you very much. But Thank you. So, and now we are really getting closer and closer to this magical buffet.
How's that in between me?
Yes, you are. But I'm pretty sure you will be very short and very on the point as always. So it's a pleasure to welcome here Johan, who is our executive director of SEI. And also, as I said in the beginning of the day, we will have three students joining us. It will be Josep Hendrik Sild, who actually got a third place in student competition Negawatt, which was competition for the ideas of how to save resources and energy. And now you are in European final of green business ideas. Kick climate, yes?
Yes, well, the final exactly just yet, more like in the Estonian final or
I'm sure you will be in the final. You're on the right track, so good luck in this competition. And then we have Anni Kotov from Academy of Arts joining us,
and Triin Kangro from Tallinn University of Technology. But I will now step aside and leave room for you, Johan.
Okay, thank you very much. Can you hear me? It's okay. So isn't it nice of Lauri to really introduce us as the barrier between, you know, the audience and the buffet?
Absolutely.
And isn't it typical that when we have the young panel, they give us 10 conclusions and so on. And Lauri was quite new in his position as the center director of Tallinn. So he asked me, can you draw some conclusion? Yeah, I like to do that. And then he met me in Stockholm. He came over, and after spending a week with me, he said, I will invite 3 students to draw some conclusions, and maybe you can moderate instead. I don't know how to interpret this, but I want to say, if I may, that I think it's been an extraordinary afternoon, really. A lot of interesting discussions, a lot of focus on Estonia, although we had a broader outlook in this final panel. And I must say that, you know, listening to the challenges here in Estonia, I think we should recognize, and this is the nice thing with Agenda 2030 and the SDGs, they are universal, they are interconnected. We all have our transition challenges. Even in Sweden, we have some risks sometimes because we end up at number 1 in all these rankings. We have huge challenges still. We all have our lock-ins. We all have our policy incoherences and challenges, really. So I think a lot of what you do here in Estonia is also something that we can learn from. And that is actually key to remember. That's my conclusion. Was short. Okay, 3 sentences. So let's move to this eminent panel. They have been asked to listening to, you know, today to the presentations and so on, different parts of the seminar. I guess you are like good academics. You don't care about instructions. So basically, you can comment basic on anything that you find interesting. Let me start with you, Triin. Yes. Electrical power engineering at Tallinn University. Yes. So I think that the transport sector is one of your key areas. Transport has been one of the areas we discussed today. What are some takeaway things that you take from the seminar? Where do you see challenges?
Well, I think Estonia, there's so many challenges, and it's... It's really hard, but right now, as they were mentioned, this road pricing, I think right now in Estonia, it's not working, because first of all, we should have this high quality roads, and this we can apply these prices if traveling is more convenient to people. They can travel faster from point A to point B. Then I think then they are ready to pay some taxes. But right now, I think this road taxing policy is maybe making these regular people more angry. And I think, first of all, we should put our money into improving our roads and improving the connections, not only in Estonia, but with neighboring countries also.
Okay, so what do you think is key for the government in terms of making sure that you do have the people with you in terms of a transition to a more sustainable transport system in that sense? What are the key things there in order to move that forward, you think? And not have people upset about things, paying high taxes and things to not
I think, first of all, a government should maybe ask more regular people opinion and to see what kind of ideas come out and maybe do some more, some research work, what can we do about it and how to present it to people.
Okay, so more sort of ownership there.
Yeah.
Annie, you work, you are a student in interior architecture at the Estonian Academy of Arts. So we quite often talk about the fact that we are building ourselves into unsustainability to a certain extent. We are locking ourselves into, regardless if we talk about energy system or houses actually. So architecture is really important here. I mean, how we are planning the next generation of infrastructure moving forward and also retrofitting the existing one. What are your perspectives in terms of the discussions we've had here, for instance, on energy efficient housing 2020 and so on?
Yes, you're absolutely true. Architecture is really important in the environmental issue regarding the fact that it's using a huge amount of energy, electricity, water, and all different kinds of materials. And if we look at natural resources, in fact, we shouldn't be building at all. We should just stop architecture. But the fact is that urbanization is growing, and also the population is growing, so we need to continue to build. And as mentioned in the housing lecture, what is important, particularly in Estonia and also other European countries, is renovation. So the question how to use buildings that are already built and how to make them either save energy or even produce energy. So I think a solution would be to really concentrate on innovations and also the fact that Estonia, as a center of technological innovations, I think we should also concentrate on finding new ways to build. Of course, also finding ways to find all the money and fundings, but also I think there is a gap on just the question how, and I think we really have the possibilities to do it because there are a lot of creative people and the boundaries are quite open. So I think this is really one of the things to concentrate on, and we should sort of rethink architecture use the fact that we are technologically really improved and just work on that and concentrate on those issues. Yes.
To rethink architecture, I think that's a good tweet. It can cause some upheaval, I guess, if we find the right channels there. Just to ask also, what I find fascinating when you're looking at many of the graphs from Estonia is, of course, you have all the graphs starting 1990, 1991, and then you have a big dip in a transition to independence, and then you see a lot of the graphs going up again in terms of how you use resources and so on. I mean, there are aspirations of people in terms of the housing, and we are looking quite often at cities. You know, there are different challenges there, environmental, social. How do you deal with that as a student, looking at social dimensions, environmental dimensions? Do you see conflicts sometimes between aspirations of people, what they would like to have in terms of housing and in a city, vis-a-vis, being resource efficient and environmentally friendly and so on?
Yeah, I think this is something also to work on because, well, people know what they want, but I think our environment is not always included in it. So they sort of put it aside, or as mentioned within the different conferences, all the people are not aware of that. So I think this is something to still work on regarding architecture and or interior architecture. So yes, I think this is something to work on
to
more.
To look further into.
Yes.
Yes, okay. Josef, you are a student in something that obviously must be very exciting because I'm not sure exactly what it is. Cyber physical system engineering, my God, that sounds modern in my ears. And obviously also in a competition that I think you have been behind partly as well, Lauri, the Negawatt. So you look at energy, and what is your take? I mean, energy is obviously an issue that seems to cause sometimes some tension in this country. Energy issues. I could feel that. What is your perspective of the discussions?
My perspective. It's actually this whole seminar. It had many different takes on energy and low carbon energy. So it's really hard to conclude it all in a few sentences. But really, my take on energy is that how we could better the world in the future is that many of the governments in the world, especially in Europe, have have made it really, really easy for especially young people to come up with ideas and then gather some kind of funding or whatever, and then take their ideas to the next level. And usually those ideas, well, if you look at them on a small scale, then they have a really, really small impact on the environment and making the world a better place. But if you escalate them to the whole world, then they really can have a significant impact there. So that is really one of my key motivations why I am doing what I am doing right now, and then trying to cut some kind of energy consumption aspects of people's everyday lives.
You are obviously an inventor also in a way, because you have this smart vent idea that is about energy efficiency in schools, if I understand correctly. When you're looking at policies then to really take this into scale and really, you know, manage to penetrate in society with these kind of inventions, what are the policy barriers that you meet as a young inventor startup company? I mean, you get some financial support, obviously, but that's not the same thing as having the right policies in place. And what do you see there?
Well, there definitely are policies that might become an obstacle when trying to take it to a larger scale. But really, the problem is trying to make a regular person understand that they need to take some actions to improve their energy efficiency and as well as their living conditions. But that's a long talk. I'm not going to do that. So I'm just going to bring a short example. The picture you saw earlier about the large regions we have in Estonia in larger cities with huge block of flats built in when we weren't independent just yet. So I live in one of those as well, in Tartu, and something like last year we applied for a credit loan that a nice young lady talked about earlier. I unfortunately can't remember your name. And then we had the whole building come together and talk about what we should do with the money. And I definitely said that maybe make the house more energy efficient or put some solar panels on the roof or something. But no, we renovated the staircases. So yeah.
So it's sometimes a bit tricky there. Anyway, we are now really the barriers between the buffet and the wine and all that. But I would still, you know, because Lauri didn't give us more than 10 minutes if we should stick to time. So still, this is a very nasty question to you, but I don't care. If you really had a chance to give your prime minister a piece of advice in your respective areas that would make, you know, many of these curves we are looking at moving to 2030 move a bit faster. I think there are someone from the Prime Minister's office here also. So, you know, it's not only for deaf ears here. What would be an example of an advice? What would you like to see from your respective areas? An advice to the government to make the transition faster. It can be big, it can be small, but just give an example. What about in the transport sector?
Well, I think that first of all, we should include more scientists.
I like that.
And we should consider this lot of opportunities that we have based on new, right now, developing technologies, that we should look into this. And I think we are really missing the real science and new developing technologies.
Okay, we're missing opportunities there, so really just get that on board in the political process.
Yes.
So how about in architecture? How do you get the shifts move faster?
I think I would say I would go sort of in the same direction, which means I think we should also put energy into innovation and science, because this is really the start of new possibilities and new ways of thinking and doing architecture. And so it means evolving universities, for example, where often very good and innovative ideas come from, and then have the government just to, as a backup, to support them. but really to focus on them, because I believe this is the future, and there are a lot of people willing to do, and so the possibilities are there.
Excellent, thank you very much.
I'm as well going to come out of my field and agree with Tina and Annie and say that that maybe the government should encourage entrepreneurs to join with universities and scientists to try and make the ideas and researches they do to make them a real thing, not just an article in Nature or whatever.
That's good. Thank you very much. I think that is really a good conclusion from the three younger panelists, and they have given us a couple of very sharp recommendations as well. I'm sure, do we have any government people in here? Yeah, there are, no. They're still there, and it's not just anyone. I know that, that's a good channel. I know that, I already learned that. So that's really good, very strong recommendations. You have a chance to discuss this even more. We are coming to an end. We will soon applaud this eminent panel. What I think is nice coming from this panel, coming from the panel before also, about mindsets that you said, Stephen, it's a lot about people in transitions. We tend sometimes to become a bit technical in our discussions. We forget that it's actually we who should transfer somehow. And that can feel a bit uncomfortable. And people are strange. Malin Falkenmark is a famous scientist actually in Sweden. She concluded after, I mean, she's now 92 and still active, but she still concluded in her youth when she was around 75 that facts are facts, but perception is reality. And I think that is, very close to how it is. So we have to work with people. And I should say that an exciting area in SEI, not least, you know, besides all these other science that we are doing, is actually an increased focus on mindsets, on people, on behavioral and behavioral changes. And because that is also behind driving development, new business ideas that Alan was talking about. If we don't have people behind ideas, we will never have the green bonds. So every sector must be innovative, and that means really focusing on people and the future generations. So in 2030, you will inherit a world, still with some challenges, I'm sure, but hopefully by then we have also taken some of the steps that you have outlined here today, and we are in a better shape than maybe some of these graphs are pointing at. So thank you first to the panel. A second thank you to the audience. I'm fascinated. In Sweden, we would have lost half the audience by this time, but I realized that this idea about the buffet and drinks afterwards tend to keep people. We should learn from that. That's a good thing. So a big applause to the audience for staying along with us here. Third thank you, and this is the third one, to Lauri and the Center for really organizing this seminar today. I think it's been extraordinary, and I hope that we will have these kind of interactions between SEI centers and the broader communities, actually in the countries where we have centers, also in the future. So a big thank you to you, Lauri, and the team around you. But then the final one also, because there is always, as always, you know, there is someone really working very hard behind. Quite often it's a center director saying, yes, it's mine, you know, I've done all this. But you know that it's not true. You know, I know that. It's always someone behind there really doing the work. And in this case, it's Helen Sarnit. Come on, stand up. So that's, yes. So thank you very much for that, Helen, working really hard. And now it is a buffet, there is some wine, and you need to continue to think, work, and be innovative. That's the only requirement we have. So thank you.
Thank you very much for this contribution. You've earned your bag, Johan, as well. Yes, thank you. And I wanted to say that you were not a barrier, but I wanted people to have the best possible first course. Entree, so you will just really get us into the mood for. Thank you.
Thank you.